Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome our keynote speaker this afternoon, Richard Roth of Dignity Health. Richard is the Chief Strategic Innovation Officer at Dignity. Dignity, as you know, is the fifth largest health system and largest hospital provider in California. In his role at Dignity, Rich creates and tests novel services, programs, partnerships, and technologies. Richard actually came in and helped develop the role of Chief Innovation Officer at Dignity, so we'll hear how that role came to be and how he helped develop that role. And in addition to his background in hospital administration, Rich has background in joint venture and startup development, mobile health, big data, venture capital, healthcare strategy, public health, and health policy. And I look forward to our discussion this afternoon. Thanks for joining us, Rich. I'd like to maybe start off with just talking about health system innovation. You recently wrote an article entitled, "Have We Reached the Bubble of Health System Innovation?" And of course, your thoughts are sort of debunking that theory, but could you talk a little bit about health system innovation and, you know, where are we along that trajectory?
Yeah, absolutely. First, thanks to UCLA, the Anderson School, the team that organized this. Awesome to be here and to have this conversation this afternoon. You know, health system innovation is just a really interesting thing that's just grown so tremendously over the last couple of years. And I think if you look at any city in the country, certainly here in LA, Cedars, Providence, UCLA, others have just really grown these innovation, these incubation functions over the last 2 or 3 years. Of course, if you look at New York, you see the same, you know, 5 or 6 organizations have done it, Dallas, et cetera. And so all of a sudden there's 30, 50, 60, 100 different of these roles in institutions setting up. And I'm from San Francisco, and so, you know, all the time you see all these people running into the same place, you're kind of like, must be a bubble, that's gonna burst. But, you know, I would look at it a little differently. I think that, you know, what we're seeing is health systems are really leaning into change. I think we're realizing, you know, regardless of what happens in the administration and the new legislation that may or may not come down, and I know you guys have talked about that earlier today, you know, health systems need to change. You can't just be the standard hospital anymore. We're taking care of very diverse populations. We need to provide value. We're too expensive. Our quality is uneven, and we own a lot of that, so we have to transform. And so I think what we're seeing is health systems saying, we're leaning in. You know, we need different competencies that we have today. We need a retail mindset. We need digital technology. We need human-centered design. We need a host of other things that are not resonant in their workforce. And they're reaching out to venture community and others and trying to bring that in. I would say that's number one. I think number two is, you know, the entrepreneurial model, you know, really has not reached its potential in healthcare because they are a separate world. And I think the two worlds coming together benefit each other. So, you know, we have real doctors, real nurses, real care situations, real patients. They have great design, great technology, et cetera. That coming together holds potential. Living in separate worlds, I think it's a challenge. And the third thing that's really exciting to me is, you know, health systems can drive their own solutions to problems investing and partnering with young companies. So if we want to say, look, if you're developing something but it doesn't touch the senior population, doesn't help us develop something else. Look, if it doesn't help with the Medicaid population because now we're at risk for this incredibly large population that in reality is most of the patients that we see, we got to develop something else. And so, you know, if it's 3 or 4 health systems together rather than one echoing that call, I think we have a great chance for innovation in the system.
So speaking of innovation, Dignity has its own sort of philosophy, if you will, the run, run, jump strategy. And could you talk a little bit about what that entails and how do you create the infrastructure to help enable that?
Yeah, I think it's really important in innovation in systems to have a defined role and a philosophy. And, you know, ours is something we call run, run, jump, and actually it's named after children's swimming classes, right? So if anyone has children, they're learning to swim for the first time. By the way, my daughter's in the first row here. You're running on kickboards, and then you finally jump in the water. So it's getting squishy, it's getting a little safe and a little dangerous, but, you know, then you jump in and you're fine. You're getting a test of it, right? And I think health systems need the same thing with all these new companies because, you know, genomics, digital technology, AI, machine learning. I mean, You know, health systems, their first role is to do no harm. Physicians, their first role is to do no harm. Those things are scary, right? You're like, what is going to happen if my patient, if you're a physician, you know, is diagnosed with this machine learning algorithm? You know, who's accountable for that? And so we've developed this philosophy we call run, run, jump. And essentially, it's three stages that lead to scaling of companies. The first run is an early stage test with a company that you bring in that tests certain KPIs that we develop. And by the way, we really like to develop KPIs that are not like 90-day readmissions or something that you're like essentially never going to be able to prove out. You need to prove out engagement. You need to prove out workflow and a bunch of other things. But so we have a first test that we do with companies. And then we learn from that. We iterate from that. But we test them against real-world situations. And we make sure that they can pass real-world scale questions such as, you know, can they pass security tests, privacy tests, other types of things. You know, and just an aside with that, you know, there's a lot of comments on early stage companies and pilots and pilotitis and you shouldn't do it. And my point is you really should do it, but you need to do it the right way. And you do no one a good service if you pilot somebody that is not going through the standard security and privacy and other processes, because, you know, then you just got to start from scratch again and no one has that time and energy. So we do that first pilot. If it works to the KPIs and our satisfaction, we automatically port them somewhere else. That's the second run. And then we mix something fundamental up, urban to rural, fee-for-value to fee-for-service, physician champion to no physician champion. And then we test, can it achieve the same KPIs in that next environment? And if it does, then we have jump, which is our scale mechanism, and we like to port things all across the system. The other big difference in our philosophy is we only do 3 to 5 things a year. We believe that, you know, it takes that time, that level, that intensity to be able to make something actually work towards scale. If you're doing 80, 90 different pilots, you have a long and hard time, I think, focusing.
Thanks, Rich. And so thinking about some of the things that might be in, you know, kind of the run, the first run, the second run, or the jump phase, could you maybe talk to the extent that you can something is, you know, the initial run versus the second run and then finally the jump phase?
Yeah. You know, one company that we worked with really early that we actually, so we have outreach and we go to universities and we're trying to see what's being going on in developing. And we found a company called Augmetics, which is Google Glass and scribing. So the value proposition is essentially if a physician is not looking at their EMR screen and that's streaming in the background in glass with software and technology and humans, that patient satisfaction will increase, B, they'll be more productive, and C, they'll be less burnout because they're not working 4 or 5 hours at night, you know, inputting things in the EMR just to catch up. And so we met the team on the Stanford campus, and we kind of really liked what they were designing and thinking about. But then it's like, wow, I'm bringing Google Glass to our enterprise, and the only time they've ever heard of Google Glass is like somebody on Mission Street that got punched in the face. It's something over the cloud. You're outsourcing things to other countries. It's got AI algorithms, and it's kind of like you're riding with the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And like the ability to get anything like that through is really hard. And so that is the first run. How do you work with those teams and get those things through and do the hard work and help a young company say, no, guys, you got to get through these standards. There is no shortcut. We have to figure out how to get through these standards, and then let's measure your KPIs. And, you know, whether that be physician satisfaction, whether that be time, whether that be time motion studies or other things. So our first run is taking through that. Now, you know, you've got to have a detailed champion to do that because on the physician side, because you're testing so many of these new things. And so that would be run one. And then run two for Augmetics, we brought it from, you know, where we were testing it. And by the way, we never test anything in San Francisco because everyone's so biased and everyone can create something better than whatever you're going to bring in. But so we tested it in Santa Maria, California. And then we brought it to Redding, so far Northern California, incredibly different environment, no physician champion, achieved the exact same KPIs, maybe even better. We brought it to Bakersfield to test it there, same thing, and now it's in the jump phase. And so, you know, we'll have hundreds probably of physicians on this technology, all achieving the same ROI as a result of the process.
Thanks, Rich. And so thinking about Augmetics, you know, we deliver not only, you know, improved experience to the patient, perhaps, because the physician's not looking at the computer screen, they're using the glass, and also the physicians must like it as well. I mean, it's providing
yes.
easier workflow. And so what are some of the things that you think about in terms of measuring both physician feedback and patient feedback, and how do you balance those two?
Yeah, you know, there is, I've yet to see any solution that comes out. I mean, you see a lot of solutions that start direct to consumer, and I think, which is great because they learn, you know, what might work in a patient setting and how that can be a satisfier and a delighter to individuals. But the reality is the business model doesn't support direct-to-consumer in 99.9% of everything that happens. So it's initial test, but, you know, then it meets workflow. And if the nurse doesn't want to adopt it, if, you know, he or she has to swivel into another chair and do something, if the doctor doesn't want to adopt it and he or she has to go into another room and operate something over here and then come back, never going to happen. And so, design meeting workflow is one of the most important things that needs to occur. And that's why I think so much of the initial emphasis needs to be, how will this work in your workflow? How will it improve your workflow? And if it doesn't improve your workflow, the hurdle is just so hard to get through. And so a lot of our energy is making sure it can be something that, you know, a physician, nurse, or others can truly use in their day and measure that it improves their time, their satisfaction, their energy. And we hope that the corollary certainly will be they will be better in providing better patient care because they're less stressed, less hurried, have more time.
And so interesting you bringing up design, because I've heard you reference the patient journey to that of the theme park visitor, in that Disney now has their visitors wear a magic band, if you will, where they can pre-order rides and pre-order food, and sort of enveloping this idea of the digital transformation. And how can health systems employ this user-centered model to improve the patient journey, much like, you know, Disney collects the data from the magic bands, not only on the front end, but on the back end, to queue lines, to pre-order food, mm-hmm. and so help you maybe with some of the workflow or operational side.
Yeah. As hospitals, health systems and hospitals move from episodic care, so, you know, you come in for that one surgery, you come in for that one visit, to, you know, being accountable for large populations and their journeys. And, you know, there's some like Kaiser that have done that a long time, but that's integrated with the insurance model. But I think what we're seeing is the evolution to this greater value-based care. So then you've got people for a lifetime and a journey. And so what is your, you know, what is the role? Do you wait for them to come in? You know, do you proactively engage them? Do you look at, you know, large data streams? And so we came up with the idea of looking at maternity as a journey, right? Which makes a total sense. And there's hips and knees and other things, but maternity to start out, and just saying from the moment that the mother conceives to when they deliver, you know, what are the, you could, let's map out that entire experience. They're, you know, meeting with obstetricians, they're going to pregnancy classes, they're getting a whole host of education. But how do we, how do we understand that, and where digitally can we help? Where in a human sense can we help to provide better satisfaction? And are we doing things early on in the journey that dissatisfy people later on in the journey, which we actually found? So, you know, we had, you know, prenatal education as an example, which conflicted with policies and procedures that we had in the hospital. And so then the nurse is sitting there and, you know, having an argument that, you know, they never should have had. Ultimately, we helped to stand up a company called Docent, which is mapping out these journeys and providing a series of digital and human-centered technology to aid in those journeys and really increase total satisfaction.
That's great. And so thinking about, you mentioned Docent, Medics, others that come to mind, Propeller Health. So mm-hmm. thinking about how you've partnered with Propeller to provide better care for asthma. Can you talk a little bit about?
Yeah, so Propeller is sensors on top of asthma inhalers. And we found this one really early as well. It's a company out of Madison, so University of Wisconsin, which is great. So we tested Propeller, and sometimes what looks like interesting and sexy isn't the interesting thing at all. And so what we thought was, where someone uses their inhaler is going to be all the difference. And you'd use your inhaler, and if you drive right instead of drive left, you'll avoid that area that's a problem. But it turns out what really ended up being interesting is when and how often. And so we were tracking patients and figuring out that, you know, these patients were using their inhalers 5 times a day, 10 times a day or more, and then reaching for their rescue inhalers a number of times. And so we were able to use that system to proactively message patients, bring them into our clinics, transform you know, their medication or something else so that they are using their inhalers as they normally should use their inhalers. And we were actually able to publish some pretty compelling evidence for Propeller that allowed us to move to our, you know, jump phase, our scale phase, that showed it reduced readmissions, it reduced emergency room visits and other types of things. The real fascinating thing is today, I actually went to a conference on public health. The number one declining health indicator in California right now is the number of children that go to the emergency room with asthma, particularly African-American children, but all children. And it's like, wow, there are these amazing inventions that are out there that could help and really address this. But it's how you get that noise out there to lots of different doctors and physicians and health systems, et cetera, because I think the potential to solve these issues is there. But the scale question is very hard.
And so thinking about scale, how can collaboration between health systems maybe enable some of that scale that you're talking about?
Yeah. This is a really interesting thing with innovation teams. I mean, I think they're certainly everyone wants to, you know, find things that are novel and interesting, and then all of a sudden, well, like, here's the blue asthma inhaler, and here's the red one, and, like, it's slightly different. But, you know, and I think that's a problem that we've got to fix. And the smarter thing is, hey, I implemented this one better, faster, with more people. Here's how I did it. Here's how I learned. Let's transfer that over to you. So, you know, Augmedix is a great example. You know, we co-invested with another large health system that we introduced it to, Sutter, who some would say is a large competitor of ours. But the reality is, that's not what competition is about in healthcare. In my mind, it's like, how do we improve things? If our competition is about this health system versus that health system, with all this other stuff going on in the ecosystem right now, you know, you'll be, you know, fighting over the last crumb. It's just, you know, we've got to get better at what we do as organizations, and we've got to use these technologies and these services to do it, and we should be incenting each other to do it faster and you know, more safely.
And so in addition to Sutter, I know you have a precision medicine collaboration with Catholic Health. Can you talk about that as well?
Yeah, and I know we probably just had a precision medicine panel here. So there's amazing, I think everyone knows that, you know, our genomics, everyone's genomics are very different, and the pathways of care that we have increasingly will be different based upon the understanding of those genomics. But here's the problem. Most cancer care is delivered in, probably 85% is delivered in community health systems all across this country. And where this genomic information is, where you're going to get access to a clinical trial, is usually in a few academic centers, which is fantastic if you have the means to get there, if you have the insurance that covers that, and, you know, of course, if the physician knows. So our Precision Medicine Institute was basically, okay, what is that information that these AMCs have, and how do we democratize that and distribute that to physicians all across the country in all kind of communities across the country so that those individuals can get the same level of information to care that if you were fortunate enough to be able to go to an AMC. So together with CHI, and you know, well, the two organizations probably touch about 25% of the country, you know, how do you use this new service to reach, you know, thousands upon tens of thousands of physicians so that if someone comes with cancer, they actually have the same information that, you know, anyone going to maybe UCLA would have.
That's great. And so thinking about, we talked a little bit about consumerization of healthcare, and also in terms of, we think of consumerization of healthcare, I think about on-demand healthcare. Mm-hmm. So sort of switching gears maybe a little in terms of how do we enable on-demand healthcare? There's a lot of different models out there. I know that you guys have recently partnered with Uber.
Yep.
Can you talk a little about how Dignity is working to either meet or at least attempt to, you know, deliver healthcare more efficiently?
So I think traditionally health systems, you know, I kind of think of it like 31 flavors, right? We're trying to, you know, become a more personalized health system, right, that understands individuals and using on-demand digital and other technologies to do that. I mean, traditionally, you know, that's been your independent physician or maybe your physician employed by a health system, and I would say that's your kind of vanilla, and lots of people like vanilla, and everyone, you know, and vanilla serves a lot of people, but you can't offer vanilla to everyone because other people have different choices, right? So someone likes Rocky Road or, you know, Orange or what have you. And so what we're trying to do is offer different flavors of healthcare at its front door. So whether that be something that's digitally enabled, virtual visits, whether that be, there's some amazing Medicare-only primary care models that are out there, like CareMore, ChenMed, you know, that is definitely going to serve a certain population much better than, you know, a broad offering would be. You know, whether it's this next generation urgent care model, which is kind of in your neighborhood and high consumer focused, and if you are a millennial, like you probably don't really care to have a long-term relationship with a physician. You just want that issue resolved so you can go back to your day, which is very different than someone might that might be a senior. So, you know, taking all that together, you know, how do you offer that menu of on-demand services, which can be digested in a way that meets individual personalized needs of various different groups. Our partnership with Uber is slightly different than other ride-sharing partnerships that people may have seen. Essentially, Uber was very concerned about the health and wellness of their drivers. These people are driving 12, 15 hours a day. I don't know the exact number, but you know, it's a hard life, and you know, they have unique issues. And we kind of said, well, how do we learn, you know, to touch this population, which is increasing, like 1099 workers in general, whether you're working for Lyft or Uber or TaskRabbit or an accountant or, you know, a consultant or something along those lines. It's a very different population than the population that might be employed by large companies. And so we're really interested in how do you serve those populations. And so, you know, our partnership with Uber was really developing some on-demand care tools to their drivers so that we can offer health and wellness services to them. And we're kind of learning and studying and understanding, you know, what unique needs they have digitally, so that can inform our care offerings. And so whether it's offering ergonomics classes because they're driving all day and their shoulders hurt and their back hurts and that's going to lead to surgery and a bunch of other things, or stress classes or men's health or other types of design tools. It's really like, how do you understand your population and how do you reach into where they're at rather than expecting them to come to you?
That's great. And so, you know, thinking about population health management, and we often talk about health systems that want to acquire small group physician offices, small care practices in order to increase their population under care. And one of the ways that people have speculated health systems can do this is through acquisition of insurance, health insurers. I know that we recently have heard about, you know, Catholic Health, one of the first insurers to enter into the health insurance market after the ACA, is now, you know, pulling back after some losses in this space, and a few others have. And my question to you, and how important is, you know, this integrated care model in terms of health provider, health insurer? How many hats do you need to wear to successfully deliver innovation?
Yeah, it's a really tough question, and there's a lot of different sides to it. You know, I would say there are, you know, there's the insurance vehicle out there, you know, there's scores of Blues, there's United, there's Anthem, there's a host of people that are very good, you know, at what they do in terms of, you know, the risk models and other types of things. They don't deliver the care, right? I mean, Kaiser, the other example, that's an insurance model that, you know, delivers care, that's, you know, has, you know, tremendous success in California. Other areas of the country where they don't have the entire model, less success, right? So, you know, I don't believe health systems in general need to become insurance companies, but I do believe that you need to take the risk. So, if the plan has the actuarial risk and the health systems have the care risk, that could be a model that could really work. So, Knox-Keene license or other types of things. So, you know, I think capitation, which is very prominent in California, has been very successful. If you look at, you know, use rates in California versus other areas of the country. You know, I think there's some great learnings there, but, you know, to assume that, you know, you as a health system, because you deliver the care, also understand the insurance business is a big leap for a lot of organizations, and I think that's where you've seen some challenges.
Right, and I think we've also seen that health insurance requires deep pockets as well.
Very deep pockets.
It's a hard to engage users if you can't mm-hmm. spend the time and money to recruit them. So you're kind of thinking about, you touched about California, and that's kind of our theme for today, caring for California. What makes California unique? What makes California different? And so what are some of the things, you know, Dignity Health being based in San Francisco and a large portion of care right. providing in California, what are some of the things that makes California unique and perhaps a more innovative place to deliver care?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the diversity of the population is, you know, it's the early indicator of what the rest of the country is going to look like. Right, so the things that we in health systems design today to care for populations in California are the things that are going to scale across the country. So that's kind of a, you know, a great opportunity, a responsibility. And so we talked about precision medicine as an example. So if we figure out, like, with these unique populations, how do we touch them today? How do we make sure that they get access to this, you know, clinical trial or this cancer therapy or a host of other things, because it's going to be a challenge because it's a mix of science, it's a mix of social engagement, and it's a mix of technology and care. And so I think California's great opportunity is using its diversity and figuring out models that go deep into communities and provide them with these resources and then allowing those to ultimately scale across the country. And I think probably the second thing is the technology environment around here. Because we are so close to so many centers of technology in California, and because these young companies need to be capital efficient, if we as the health systems and payers and pharmacy companies and others in California can be the early customers first, it's going to allow those companies to be more successful over time because they're not expending capital on plane flights and hotels and all of these other things that really stretch young organizations. And so, I think that's why you see so much activity in California around early stage.
And so it's interesting. I'm thinking, you know, in my role, I see a lot of startups come across, and I see, you know, those pitching to health systems, those pitching to manufacturers, and you know, I always wonder how many workflow management tools, you know, in terms of these opportunities, does a health system need, or how many, EMR interfaces or add-ons or APIs are you looking for? And so, kind of, what advice would you give to you for those that are, you know, early stage entrepreneurs in health tech, if you will, or digital health, what are health systems looking for? What might be on the horizon in terms of the next 5 years of innovation?
Yeah, it's really interesting. I mean, like, so many population health tools, you know, like I can't even open my email without another AI offering today, and I don't even know, I haven't responded to the first one. But I think where people are missing an opportunity is the operations of the care sites today. So, you know, all the health systems have these incredibly large hospital operations, which, you know, regardless of if you talk about hospital, you know, population health or other types of things, that's not going away. People need those, but they're expensive, they're depreciating, they have huge capital commitments, there's large workforces that, you know, enable them to care for patients every day. So, you know, how are we helping the nurses in care systems? How are we helping the doctors in hospitals? How are we helping laboratory technicians or others be more efficient with their workforce and be more satisfied in their profession day to day? I mean, I think there's a lot of ideas to go to these greenfield genomics or machine learning or other types of things. There's a lot of excitement there. There's a huge market within the hospital walls, and people tend to forget it.
That's interesting. Thanks. And, you know, thinking about, you know, from where I sit in med tech, I see there is a need for more discussions between the big manufacturers even and the health systems. And, you know, how often are those conversations taking place? You know, you're talking to the entrepreneurs yeah. and, you know, other health systems, but how can we get more collaboration or more conversations going between those two?
Yeah, I think in even large technology companies you see, but yeah, devices, med tech, you know, that's hard because often their standard relationships are with the supply chain areas of the organization, and so it's not a strategic relationship as much as a, cost and value type of relationship. I would encourage that world to be engaging more with, different audiences in the healthcare ecosphere instead of just the supply chain side, because, you know, the supply chain are very competent but charged with a very specific goal, which may not work well with, you know, creating a new feature or function or capability. And you know, of course, those med devices need to prove that those capabilities provide even more value, But it's tough to do that when you're, you know, sitting in that negotiation chair versus a different chair.
So it'd be great to have maybe have some of those conversations happening, you know, before we get to that value analysis committee meeting or wherever it is.
Exactly.
And maybe more broadly across the organization. Mm-hmm. That's great. So kind of, I want to leave a little bit of time for questions. I have a few kind of wrap-up questions. Maybe we'll leave about 15 or 20 minutes for questions from the audience. You know, thinking about sort of, we talked a little bit about, you know, what's next in terms of healthcare and innovation. What would you like to, you touched on a little earlier, but what would you like to see in terms of maybe it's an operational opportunity within the health system, but what would you like to see in terms of innovation for healthcare as a whole?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, operations in the health system is a big opportunity. Anything focused on Medicare and Medicaid populations, again, like people in the digital health realm like to start in, you know, with consumers. It doesn't help us if someone used to go 10,000 steps and now they're going 15,000 steps, and they have commercial insurance, and you know, if you only pay another $200 on top of that a month, you know, we're going to have this great solution for you. That it's great. It's a small population, and we do want those people to be healthier. But the big populations are Medicaid and Medicare, and really actually pre-Medicare. And so, thinking about those more complex population groups with solutions will, I think, allow for greater change than where some of the things are focused today.
That's great. And so, kind of thinking about, you know, what are some of the barriers that are going to prevent innovation from happening in terms of whether it's innovation in the Medicare population or Medi-Cal population, if you will, in California, and how can we overcome some of those?
Yeah, I think a couple of the barriers: understanding workflow, making sure that you're offering a solution that can work and fit into workflow and isn't designed in an entirely separate ecosystem, and that means understanding payer environments and EMR requirements and other types of things. Again, there are no easy steps in that world because, you know, it's just, there's too much concentration in large EMR systems to really think about you're going to be going outside of that wall. Working on workflow, winning the hearts and minds on workflow, and focusing on these differential populations where there are not solutions today that are working. And it's harder. There's no doubt it's harder, but I think the long-term potential is just so much greater for any young company entering those spaces.
That's great. And you kind of maybe wrap up question before opening up to the audience. I want to think about, we have a lot of MBAs in the room here, a lot of members of the Healthcare Business Association who are working hard to put on today's event and also just, learn about what the challenges of healthcare are today. And, in your role, not only you oversee innovation strategy, oversee part of the venture fund within Dignity Health. So sort of what advice can you give, maybe two parts to MBAs looking to enter, the world of health systems, whether it's in administration or another capacity, and implement change, and also just perhaps, a greater role within healthcare where they can make a difference?
Yeah, I think this is the time. I mean, the healthcare industry in large measure is exiting one chapter and about to enter another chapter, right? And so I think the ACA started that, but it didn't necessarily change everything, probably the way that, we're going to see over the next couple years. And I'm not talking legislatively, I'm just talking more technology, what is the role of machine learning, what is the role of genomics, what is the role of social services, right? And how do we connect social services and care in a way that actually works and is meaningful? So I'd say, those are incredible areas. So, don't think of your world as I'm just going digital or I'm just going care or, I'm in this one area. We need people that can cross areas and that communicate between areas. So, if there's an amazing technology, but you can't communicate it to a physician and you can't communicate it to, a social worker, et cetera, this doesn't work, and they're not in isolation like that. They're integrated, especially for the populations that we're dealing with in this state. You need something that, is both tech and touch, and the people that can kind of understand and respect that and work within those worlds, I think will be successful.
That's great. Thanks. And so I want to give a chance to open up for questions from the audience. So
how did you create your role at Dignity Health as a chief innovation officer? I think a lot of health systems have talked about innovation and have innovation incubators and lots of different options, but there's very few systems that actually have a chief innovation officer. And from what I've read, it sounds like you created your own role. Right. How?
Yeah, it's such a, starting at the top, you know, I've got an amazing CEO, Lloyd Dean, that believes in innovation and believes that innovation can make change in the world. And so nothing happens without supportive leadership. And so, you know, I give all the credit to Lloyd, to Charlie Francis, who's our chief strategy officer, that, you know, both deeply believe that innovation is meaningful and that you need to focus on it. And then two is, you know, we began to think a lot about it as, you know, I think a lot of systems, a lot of people get stuck as, what is innovation? And then you're like sitting in a 40-hour meeting with like people saying, no, this is innovation, no, that's innovation, this doesn't count, that doesn't count. And so we kind of said, we're not going to get in that fight. We're just going to say, we're doing strategic innovation. And no one knew what that term meant, and we just made it up. I mean, we filled it in. We just kind of said, it means these three or four things. It means IP and tech transfer. It means working with early stage companies, and it means creating new companies, and it means investing, and that's strategic innovation. So we funneled that in and said that's what it is, and then we just manage it like a portfolio. You know, some years in our portfolio, our IP stuff does tremendous value for it. That's, you know, our physicians, our nurses, our laboratory technicians, our security guards, others creating things, and, you know, we commercialize that, and that's fantastic. Some years our investing does really well. Some year we create new companies because, you know, providers are becoming payers and payers are becoming services companies, and we've got to decide what a health system is. And, you know, we create a new company and launch it into the ecosphere. We just did one called Oncoverse, which is really exciting. But, you know, you manage it like a portfolio every year, because I think if you double down into just one thing, we're going to be the best investors. Yeah, you're probably not going to be as good as, you know, Andreessen Horowitz and Sequoia Capital and a bunch of other people that really know what they're doing in that space. But it's, you know, it's really tempting to fall into that because you're seeing so many things and you're seeing what your physicians or nurses are really excited about. But, you know, ultimately, I think, you know, the value of a portfolio makes for a good innovation office.
Kind of along those lines of, you know, not coming from a true investment, you know, VC type of background, how do you look at early stage companies and how do you judge whether or not they're the right fit? You talked a little bit about just the market they might be serving, whether it be Medicare or Medicaid, but is there a traditional investment view to that where you're looking closely at the founders, at the market size, different stuff like that as well?
Yeah. So the way that we've set it up is we're a strategic co-investor. So, you know, we look at the founder and the team as well as they're working with our team and do they fit in the culture in the right way. But we always partner with a lead investor that does the investment, that, you know, their expertise is, you know, what is the team, what is the market, what is the broad potential, who are the competitors in the space, et cetera. And so we provide the strategic insight. Will this work in our care sites? And will we expand it? Yes or no? Right, on both of those questions. And they provide, you know, all of the other kind of market validation. And then, you know, we join as a strategic and co-invest alongside of them. But, you know, I just personally don't believe, at least for Dignity, we have the capability and the competency to answer a lot of the other questions that you raise. And there are people that are experts at doing that. And, you know, I'm a big believer in working with experts that do things.
Hi, thank you so much for coming today. So I'm one of those early stage companies. It's Medango, and we're trying to go after Medicaid and Medicare populations. And sort of a two-pronged question, as somebody who's just come out of an entrepreneurship program, I feel like lean and these odds and these investors, it's not very sexy to say I want to serve the sickest and the poorest population, and they aren't really excited about your idea. But then again, B2C is not necessarily a valid solution. So I sort of would love to sort of hear your insights about how you balance sort of this business, sort of new, shiny, selling it to people who could afford it, having that payer predetermined, but also being like, we are serving health systems, they have big populations, we want to create really good, really powerful social impact on healthcare. And sort of, how do you make the sell to both sides, and how do you navigate that space? Thanks.
Yeah, that's a tough position a lot of organizations are in. I think that, again, I think the D2C is really good for refining your product and, you know, working on, you know, that side of the design and consumer acceptance and how you're, you know, engaging with consumers to help continually redefine what you're offering. but it's just a very challenging long-term market for a lot of organizations, and most have pivoted more to a B2B to C. But healthcare organizations are looking for B2B to C, especially in those populations that you're talking about. So to the extent that you're exploring an early stage relationship with a healthcare system, you know, with a venture arm potentially, it might be a good strategy for you know, what you're trying to do with your company. But I think you need to try to get into that space. And I would say, you know, often an enterprise quality health system as opposed to a standalone hospital, you know, in one other area, because increasingly the standards for working at enterprise are just very different from standalone. And sometimes the investments you might make to be standalone ready may not translate to where you're gonna need to be an enterprise.
Thanks again, Rich. Appreciate it. One of the interesting things that I heard you speak often about is your engagement from physicians and nurses, your security officers in this process. How did you foster that engagement at Dignity, and where, how far have you taken that engagement? Have you allowed them to partner in the kind of the spinoff or growth of some of your innovations?
Yeah, we have an IP policy. My colleague Manoja Lakamwasam leads our IP for us, and she's a brilliant executive. You know, so we have an IP policy where if employees create things that we end up commercializing, they get 40%, and then the organization, this is really important, the hospital that they came from gets 40%, because we want to incent people, allowing people to work towards those innovations, and then we take, our area takes the remaining percent, so that helps with attorneys and other types of fees that you know, we might need to help commercialize things. And so you know, we've done employee challenges. They work sometimes, like we have a green light challenge, which is broad employee idea challenges. But you know, often we work in, you know, very focused areas where we think we're likely to get larger, more complex care sites, these innovations coming out of. You know, we've had a few that have been really successful. It's a challenging process. It takes a lot of time, but we do really believe in incenting the inventors, even when they're employees, because ultimately, if it's going to work, they're going to need a lot of our system's time, and we want to be able to make sure that they can do that.
So I've known you for a few years now. I know you travel a lot to a lot of these conferences and absorb all this new information, ideas. So my question to you is, how does Dignity prioritize? Like, I mean, you've probably been pitched like hundreds of ideas, right, every day or every week. Yeah. What is the bottom line? Like, what's the criteria of saying these are the top areas, these are the top focus areas, or this is the value that I'm looking for, and so I'm going to prioritize these ideas and say I'm going to pilot this first and the other later?
Yeah, we set forth themes with our management team, you know, I wouldn't say it's every year, but over frequencies that are the themes that we really, really want to focus on. So one theme might have been patient as consumer, and then we're doing, you know, Go Health, our digital, our new urgent care technology, or we might be doing something digital, or another theme might be care coordination or continuum of care, or a third theme might be operational excellence. And I think, you know, that's a theme that's very pressing for us. So if something helping within our operations, I'm much more likely to kind of look at that and think about that right now than, you know, a certain, you know, other technology that might be emerging. But we really stick to three or four key themes, and we try to just really analyze things in those themes.
And sometimes you probably are also looking at the business unit and their priorities, right? I know that, like, when we are trying to sell the Dignity, I'm always, like, looking at, on the business side, is there a priority or initiative happening that year that way we can tie our product
That's right. That, yeah, exactly right. And that's another, like, huge learning, I think, for people, which is you want to swim with the tide. You want to, you know, like, if people are trying to solve those problems and you're offering that problem and they're going to be customers that pay for that problem, that's a great space to be in. I think other innovation efforts, sometimes you're kind of in a, you know, a silo on your own or a building on your own or other types of things, and you're solving things within that building, but if it doesn't translate, it doesn't scale.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you so much for being here. So you had mentioned when you were looking at the adoption of the Google Glass that you kind of chose a place, I don't remember the exact word that you used, but that wasn't really early adopters, those type of people that were maybe excited about this new product. How did you go about selling that innovation to that group of physicians? and maybe talk a little bit more about why you chose that group.
Yeah, so usually for our first sites, we always choose somewhere that has a physician that's a strong champion. And we're collecting data and we're collecting KPIs. And often, you know, in the design of those KPIs, we engage other people in the organization, including many that are probably not fans, just to get their feedback. And they're like, well, if it could do this, you know, I might be interested. And so that's kind of the hook, right? And so ultimately, you know, it's with data, right? And you've got to demonstrate data after your first run, because if you don't have good data, very few people want to scale it, especially if you're ambivalent or not necessarily, you know, an early champion. But I think what we found is with the right data, you can convince people.
Thanks. So perhaps just one closing question to wrap up on the audience questions about, you talk a lot about KPIs, yep. And then sort of key performance indices or right. Such. And, you know, I know that from my perspective, we see a discussion often emerging between, you know, traditional clinical trials, what is efficacy? And then in digital health and, you know, some of these other tools, we have things thinking about more effectiveness. And right. It's something I hear, you know, Evidation Health talk about. You're looking at what are the appropriate indices and measures for digital health tools in the health systems, and how is that different from perhaps traditional viewpoints on you know, primary and secondary endpoints in your more traditional style clinical trial, and how do you choose those KPIs with that in mind?
Yeah, and Evidation's a great company, and I really like what they're doing because they're, you know, helping enable evidence for an area that you know, is opaque for a lot of individuals. And so, you know, I think clinical trials are an entirely different, separate bucket, and if you have to go through the IRB route for, you know, because you're, you know, directly addressing an issue of safety or something along those lines, you got to follow those down those paths. But a lot of the digital interventions are engagement-based interventions, and so, you know, it's how engaging it is, and is it changing outcomes based upon the engagement, and how is it impacting workflow, and those are things that can often be studied outside an IRB. And so we often focus there because those are the things that I think could be more readily scalable. But, you know, if you are changing an intervention, you really do have to go through that IRB process. And so I think tools like Evidation are going to be really impactful. Another one, Science 37, if you have all heard about that, which is kind of democratizing the way clinical trials are done, going right to patients in their homes, which is another really fascinating way to think about IRBs and how to. Because if, you know, and the great secret to HIPAA is if the patient consents, it's fine. Everyone's afraid of like HIPAA, but the reality is if a patient wants to try something and they sign for it, great, you're done. And so, you know, I think companies are starting to figure out ways to effectively work that hidden resource that is the patient that wants their issue solved.